Wow. Good morning, Harvest. That's the second time I've ever heard that song. The first time was the first service, and that is fantastic. I can't believe that's our worship team. That's wow. The Lord inhabits the praises of His people. The joy of the Lord is my strength. It's in worshiping Him that we find all of the perspective, all of the strength, all of the help that we need. And I love that He's given that to our church through our worship team. So fired up about worship night. I will see you Thursday night. It's going to be good. Hey, I have something else to talk about, though, too, and it's God's Word. I'm thrilled about that. I'm thrilled for the opportunity to speak of what God has said already. You need to know that when we get up for a message, we don't think the message is the thing. We think the message is a signpost pointing to the reality of what God's Word has to say. It is living, it is active, it accomplishes the purpose for which it was sent. I love that this summer the Lord has been using a bunch of people in our church to bring His Word. I think that's really great. It makes it so clear it's about Him. And I'm thankful for Pastor John and Heath and Ramirez and Eddie and Dave Stone and just all the different ways that God is getting His work done. We're very, very thankful. Today, we're going to continue our series, Unsung, Everyday People, Uncommon Faith. And I relate to that. I resonate with that because I'm an everyday people just like you. And but I want my faith to be honoring to Jesus Christ and used for His agenda. Today we're going to get into John chapter 4. You can start heading that way, the Gospel of John chapter 4. And here's the theme. Have you ever been in need of refreshment? Have you ever been in need of strength or encouragement or hope or healing or peace? Yeah, of course. We all desperately need the Lord's help in these things. We come to places where I don't know what to do. I don't know what's next, but I know who I need to turn to. It's God and His Son, Jesus Christ. I was coming to church last night and I saw a friend. I said, "How you doing?" He said, "It's been a bad week." It's like, well, I'm really glad you're that honest in church. This is the best place to be honest. And whether it's been a bad week or a bad month or maybe a bad year, we look to the Lord for hope. I was talking to another friend this morning, and this was the week of the funeral, and we're seeking the Lord's comfort, and we need His help. And God is our help, and He is our refuge, and He is near to the brokenhearted. And so today, quite simply, we're going after this concept that we can be refreshed by living water. That's what this passage is all about. So I want to pray, and then we're going to jump into this together. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we commit this time to You. We ask You to lead. We ask You to direct. This is Your word, and it is a revelation of Your Son, Jesus Christ. Everything else is inconsequential. So Lord, would You lead us now, stir our hearts to turn to You, the living God, when we are in need of refreshment. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, John chapter 4, did you find it? I would just, if I could encourage and challenge you to, when you come to church, your Bible's got to come with you, because we don't have anything to say if it doesn't come from God's Word, nothing worth hearing. And so I hope you've got a copy or borrow with neighbors or whatever. There's some under the chairs. John chapter 4. Interestingly, John chapter 4 comes right after John 1, 2, and 3. Did you know that? Yeah, this is I try to help. Here's why I say that. Jesus' ministry is underway. Jesus' ministry is underway. John 1 starts with the reality that the Word of God has become flesh. God has taken on the form of flesh in the form of Jesus Christ. That's in John chapter 1. Jesus was preceded, He was announced, He was heralded and identified by His cousin John the Baptist. Did you know that? That's all happening in the early chapters of John. Jesus is calling His disciples, Andrew and Simon Peter and Philip and Nathanael, and He keeps saying to them, come and see. Come and see what I'm going to do. Come and see who I am. He does His first miracle in the first chapters of John, the wedding feast at Cana. He turns water into wine. He also cleanses the temple of unrighteous money changers. He's not playing games. He's at the Passover feast. He's doing signs. People are beginning to turn and follow Jesus. This is the context that we're in. And then there's a verse in John 3. Does anybody know one of those verses in John 3? Maybe 16? You know, the maybe best known verse in Scripture, Jesus saying his love for the Lord is shown through the love of God in Jesus Christ. And then we read that Jesus' disciples were beginning to baptize those who were choosing to follow Jesus. Context matters, and that's where this is landing. So now we turn the page to John chapter 4, and we're going to look at this story about refreshment that can be found by the living water of Jesus Christ. Let's start in chapter 4, verse 1. Now, when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee, and he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. Now, all of this is important for context. And what did you catch that first verse? Did you diagram that? What's happening in that first verse? Let's go back to it. Now, when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing disciples, see, I had to read that like three times to understand what it was saying. What's happening is this. The Pharisees are observing Jesus on their radar. Oh, he's getting more followers than John. I wonder what that's all about. And Jesus knows that there is a necessary confrontation coming with the Pharisees, but not yet. And so when he hears that, okay, they're picking up on this and they're starting to understand and they're starting to follow and it's going to be a thing, not yet. And so he goes the other way. He goes from Judea, departs for Galilee, and he goes where? Through Samaria, okay? He's left, he's headed to Samaria, he's in Sychar, the town, and he's at a place called Jacob's Well. It's a historical place, it's there today. It's a place where people would come to get water. We also know that he's tired. He's sitting by the well, and it's, what time is it? The sixth hour. What does that mean? Well, in this vernacular, what that means is it's about noon. So 6 a.m., beginning of the day, first hour, sixth hour, now noon. Okay, got it? That's our context. It's within that that I want to give you our first point, which is this. My source of refreshment is Jesus. Man, I love the simplicity and clarity of that thought. My source of refreshment is found in Jesus. I just want to highlight, Jesus and his disciples, if you looked on a map, they took the shortest distance between Judea and Galilee. The straightest path they could take, the shortest line, was through Samaria. But can I just tell you that a lot of Jews, there were racial tensions between Jews and Samaritans. And there were Jews who would make that trip and they would intentionally take the long way so that they would not have to associate with or go through Samaria. That's unrighteous. That's wicked. But that was the culture. There was that much tension. So here we are, Jesus with a Samaritan woman at the well. I bet you would too. She came for water. Isn't that what you do at a well? She came for water. She came for refreshment. It seems as if she's alone. And it's the middle of the day. And those are two really unusual things that matter for this story. It would be typical of the women to come together, to do this together. Let's do this work together of gathering the water and taking it back to town. She's not with anyone. It would also be typical if you had a hard job to do on a hot day. You want to do it at noon? No, it was more typical to go early in the morning or to go late in the evening. So here's a woman on her own at the well at noon. Did she run out of water? Did she not plan well for the day? Or did I plan to come at a time when I wouldn't have to interact with others? I'm not sure, but I think it might be more of that as we read through Scripture. So look at verse 7. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. So Interesting. Jesus intentionally engages with the Samaritan woman. He is blowing through the racial barriers. He's blowing through the gender relationships, and he's saying, I want to interact with you. Now, it sounds maybe self-serving, I need a drink, but he's about to offer her something that is truly a gift of eternal life. She says, how is it that you, a Jew, would ask me, a Samaritan, for a drink? Because Jews had nothing to do with Samaritans. Oh, now you want to talk to me, huh? Because you need water? I don't know all that she thought about this, but this is for sure out of the box for a Jewish rabbi to talk to a Samaritan woman on their own. Jesus is after her heart, and he's going to engage her intentionally, okay? Now, maybe you feel some of the tension in this. When I was thinking about the Samaritan woman says, how is it that you, a Jew, would ask me for a drink? I was trying to bring this home, you know. So just for what it's worth, I'm a Cubs fan, okay? And I have friends. I love them. I don't understand them, but they're Sox fans, okay? And I was trying to think, like, if I were super thirsty and I was at my friend's house, some of them are in this room. Hopefully we'll still be friends. If I was at my friend's house, I was super thirsty. I'm like, can I get something to drink? And they handed it to me in a Sox cup. Could I drink it or not? I don't know. These are dilemmas. And that's silly, right? By the way, someone after the first service gave me a White Sox pencil. So I guess I can expect a lot of fun with that. The point is this. I don't know if I want that quite like that. And it would be very unusual for a Jewish person to say, I want help from this Samaritan woman. And that's exactly what he does. I want to engage with her. I want to talk to her. Look at verse 10. Jesus answered her and said, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. I love this. Jesus takes the very practical, very real, fundamental need that she has for water. And he's like, I don't really want to talk about water. I want to move this to your heart. I want to move this to the thing you need more than anything else. You need soul refreshment, satisfaction, hope, forgiveness. Do you think she understands it yet? I don't think so. Let's keep reading. Verse 11, the woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Now, she's like totally on the horizontal plane, right? You didn't bring a bucket. You don't have a rope. Where are you going to get living water? I mean, it sounds good on paper, but you got no plan. There's no way this is happening. She's not seeing it. See, he's trying to lift her eyes from the mundane to the miraculous. You need this drink of water for satisfaction of your thirst. I want to give you living water for your soul. And then she says, are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well, and he drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock. Okay? Look at where Jesus goes. He's on a mission here. He's pressing in. Listen to 13. Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. Man, I love that. I love that. Jesus has very intentionally and completely blown past the racial barriers, the gender barrier, the culture barrier, because he says, this woman needs what I can offer. This woman doesn't need a drink. She needs her soul to be satisfied in me. The racial divide is nothing. And he sees that she's alone at midday at the well, and he intentionally reaches out to connect with this woman. I absolutely love that. Can I tell you, I think Jesus does this today. He's overcoming all the obstacles. There's nothing that confines him. He reaches past the constructs that to us seem limiting, and he reaches right to the heart of the person, maybe to you, maybe to me, and he says, I have what you've been longing for. When you taste what I have, you'll never thirst again. Don't worry about that bucket of water. I've got something better for you. You know, it's been a bit of a warm week, and have you ever been in this spot? This happened to me yesterday. I was working in the yard. I was cutting the grass and pulling some weeds, and we were going to have some people over, trying to make your yard look good, and it was hot, and I was out, and I was sweaty, and sorry, too much info, but I was thirsty. Like, I wanted some refreshment, so I went, I mean, like probably a lot of you do, I went in, men do this a lot, we go in and just open the fridge, right? Like, what's in here? It's like a new mystery every time. And so I was like, I know what I need. I need refreshment. I need cold liquid that will refresh me. That is what I need. So I just kind of reached in for the first thing. I'm like, awesome. This is going to be great. And this was not great. This is apple cider vinegar. Always the wrong choice, okay? Don't go there. So I thought, well, that didn't work out very well. And then I thought, well, here, this looks better. I like Mountain Dew. That's not Mountain Dew. That's lemon juice, okay? That's not going to satisfy your thirst. It might appear to be useful for, and it is useful for some things, but not for that purpose. It can't quench your thirst. And then I looked a little further, and I found this and realized it was diet, so I put it back. But then I found this. And I just got to say, I'm a fan. And when it's hot and it's cold and I'm like, it's great, okay? But I had that at about 2:00, and by 2:45, I'm like, I'm thirsty. I need some actual water. I need something that will actually quench my thirst. And so I found water. There's nothing better than water when you're thirsty, right? I like the two of those other things. I don't, but water quenches your thirst. But you know what? I had that yesterday. And today, I was thirsty again. So listen, I think we are people who are so prone to be satisfied or seek to be satisfied in things that could never fully satisfy us. And there are certain choices we can make. They're never going to be the right thing. They're not God's plan for you. That relationship, that path, that thing, that won't satisfy because it's not for that. This might seem good, but it's for the wrong purpose. You're getting this out of order. And even the things that seem so good in the moment, they can't quench our thirst, okay? Jesus Christ says, I want to give you a spring of life within you that you would never thirst again. It's interesting, the woman at the well, what's her name again? I don't know. It's not in there. I think that's really helpful, and I think it's instructive, because I can see myself in her spot, and I think you can see yourself in her spot. I need the Lord to refresh me. Augustine, a church father, said this, "Thou hast formed us for thyself, and our hearts are restless till they find rest in thee." You're not going to find lasting, real soul satisfaction until you put your hope completely in Jesus Christ. And then you will find all that you ever longed for and more. This is a really important point. Was the woman seeking Jesus? Not at all. Was Jesus seeking her? Oh, for sure, for sure. That's the way we are too. The scriptures say we're spiritually dead until we give our life to Christ. I'm not about to do anything good. But he sought me. He reached out to me. He offered hope to me. He offered forgiveness to me in spite of me. And he's doing the same thing for us. You need refreshment? You're going to find that only in Jesus Christ. Stop settling for substitutes. Even the best of life can't satisfy your soul. There's people in here today, I'm convinced of it, every service. You need to turn to Jesus Christ. You have not yet made that decision. Today could be the day. And then there's many of us who need to return to Jesus Christ. I do love him, but I have wandered and I have got caught up in the things of this world and found that they are not satisfying. Only Jesus can truly refresh your soul. So Jesus is the only source of refreshment, of soul refreshment. Second point is this, my awareness of sin is the start. How am I going to find refreshment? I have to come face to face, come to grips with my own sin. And Jesus is about to take this a lot deeper and a lot more personal. Look at verse 16. Jesus said to her, go call your husband and come here. Now wait, were we not just talking about water and a well and living water? What just happened there? Well, I think there's two things he's doing. First of all, that would be proper culturally to say, I'm not going to continue to have a conversation one-on-one with you, but why don't you go get your husband? Let's have this conversation together. So there's a proper sense of that. But I think there's something much more. I think there's a very pointed and piercing thing that Jesus is doing. He's about to put his finger on probably the point of her greatest need and her greatest pain. And that might seem hard, but he does it in such a loving and gracious way. The woman answered him, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you are right. Now listen to this answer, and listen to his grace, and listen to the truth, because he's full of both. You are right in saying, I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true. Can you hear? That's just, he's not beating her up. He's being very gracious. You said what is true, but there's actually more to that story, and I know it. It's quite personal. It's invasive and in a very intentional way. In this moment, Jesus is revealing his divine knowledge, right? Because he's fully God and he's fully man, and he reveals to her that I know everything. But he's also choosing very lovingly to engage with a broken person that the culture would say is not someone he should engage with. He's blowing right through that to say, I want to tell her what she really needs. I thought about it like this. Think about this personally. Jesus knows. He knows that you're broken. And he knows that you know you're broken. He will offer grace if you will choose humility. If you will embrace what he has to offer, you will find refreshment for your soul. Jesus is right in saying you have no husband. He knows the whole story. And this is probably her most painful reality. Without casting any judgment, that's painful. That's hard. Now, so what is she going to do? She says in verse 19, the woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. You nailed it. That's exactly true. How could you know that? You can't know that unless you're a prophet. And then, you know, so have anybody run into a prophet this week? Like, what do you talk to a prophet about? You know, I don't know. But she chooses to, let's talk about worship for a minute, you know? Maybe it was an awkward pause. Maybe it was, can we talk about something else? I'm not quite sure. But she says, I perceive that you're a prophet. And then in verse 20, our fathers, she says, worshipped on this mountain. But you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. Okay, now what's happening there? Well, she's a Samaritan, right? The Samaritans worship. They built a temple on a place called Mount Gerizim. It is nearly adjacent to where they were. So it's quite possible she's saying, we say we worship here. But she knew Jesus was Jewish. And so the Jews, you say, you worship in the temple in Jerusalem. So she's bringing up a bit of a like, well, I wonder what the truth really is. And you say, and I say, listen to what he says. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. Man. He just keeps cranking it up, and he's like, I want to tell you something. I want to tell you what's true. I want to show you worship like you've never seen. But you got to see, she is starting to understand that my source of refreshment can be found in Jesus. That's what he's telling me. And I am more aware now, after this conversation, of my great need, the biggest place of my heartache, the biggest failure of sin. That's the beginning. The question is, what is she going to do with it? Loved ones, you and I, we are fully known by God and by his son, Jesus Christ. You're not pulling anything off that he doesn't see. We're fully known. Every point of failure, pain, sin. Honesty about my deepest need for him is the beginning of true hope. Sometimes as a pastor, I hear people express very painful realities and very hard things, but I can tell you that there are times when that depth of pain, I'm like, this is the beginning of hope, because you've come to the end of yourself, because you realize, I can't do this. Now I'm going to turn to Him. Bring your brokenness to Jesus, and He offers to respond to you with grace. And that moves us into our third point. My worship of God is the response. What do I do when I recognize He's the hope and He's the satisfier of my soul? What do I do when I come face to face with my biggest failures, my heartache, my pain, my sin? Well, my worship of God is the response. That's what we're called to do. Jesus in this passage is changing it all. He's changing it all. And so I read again in 21. Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father." Now that is a huge sentence, because he's like, it's all going to change. It's not going to be like you think or what the Jews have thought up to this point. You worship, verse 22, you worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. Now, if you're reading, you're like, wow, he's kind of high on his high horse. I mean, what in the world? He's speaking truth. He's confirming what Scripture said, that God made a covenant with his people Israel, that he was going to bring the Messiah out of the Jewish people. He's saying exactly what Scripture says. Salvation is from the Jews. But look at verse 23. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. The response required to God when we understand our great need, when we see our own sin, is this: to worship him. God is spirit, and we need to worship him in spirit and in truth. It's not about a building. It's not about a town, a location. It's about a heart surrendered to him. He is spirit. I worship him in my spirit. He is truth. I worship him in truth, informed about who he is through scriptures, through his son, Jesus Christ. How should we respond to Jesus? He's the source, the only source of soul refreshment. He's the perfect one who was, while sinless, is completely aware of my deepest sin. And he's not walking away from me, he's walking to me. I want to show you that you can have life and you can have satisfaction. And like he does so often, using the physical realities to point out the spiritual needs. He's the source of soul satisfaction, and we're to respond to him. Think about the things we sing in worship. You are who you say you are. Lord, you're worthy. We say, you're all I need. Those can't be words. That has to be a growing reality of my soul. I need you, Lord. I submit to you. I honor you. I love the announcement video for the worship night. What more can I offer for my Savior? This is not minimalistic. Did I knew enough? It's what else could I give in worship to my Savior? True worshipers will respond with worship that is in spirit and in truth. I was really ministered to, I said it before, by that song today. As I lift up a song, your spirit is lifting me. You need refreshment? You're going to find it in the presence of the Lord. You're going to find it through the willful decision to worship him. When I say who he really is, he lifts my head. He lifts my spirit. He sustains me with strength that is not my own. It's amazing. All right. We're going to go on to point four. My witness for God is the result. Okay, my worship of God is the response, but my witness for God is the result. So let's look at verse 27. Oh, but I can't even believe I missed this verse. Hang on. Verse 25. The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming. He who is called Christ." So think about this. He gets into this whole thing about worship, and you say you worship here, and I say, the Jews say we worship in Jerusalem, but the true worshipers worship in spirit and truth, right? And she maybe didn't, I don't know what she thought about that. Doesn't quite tell us. What she does have faith to believe is that Messiah is coming, and we're going to get the answer when he shows up. You can think what you think, I can think what I think, but when Messiah comes, it's going to be clear, she says to Jesus. Look at what the next verse says. Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." Wow. This is it. He's revealing himself to her. Did he go to the kings and the royalty? Did he go to the religious rulers? No. He went to the woman who was at the greatest point of need, and he said, "I am the Messiah." Let me tell you what worship really is. Let me tell you how you're to respond. And she responds. Look at verse 27. Just then, his disciples came back. Man, those poor guys, they missed that whole thing. They were on a food run. They were going to get food. They marveled that he was talking with a woman. But so for sure, they asked him about it, right? No. They marveled he was talking with a woman, but no one said, "What do you seek?" Or, "Why are you talking with her?" I love when human nature is just so evident in Scripture. They're thinking about it. You ask him. You ask him. I'm not going to ask him. But they see it. They're like, this is unusual. Verse 28, so the woman left her water jar and went away into town. Now, is this not at a well? What was the purpose of going to a well? Is it to get water? So I brought my water jug and I'm going back without my water jug. Her eyes are being opened that it's not actually water that you need. It's living water in Jesus Christ. And so I don't need this. I'm leaving it here. And went away into town, and she said to the people, look at verse 29, "Come, see a man who told me all that I ever did." Okay, quick, just think about this for a second. She's had 5 husbands. She has one now who's not her husband. She's in a town. Do you think people in the town knew her reality? I do. I think that's reasonable to think that, I think she was known. I think that was probably common information. I'm just going to guess. Come, what does she have to say? "Come see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" Now, what I love about this is she took what she knew and she went to tell other people about it. I got to say that in watching the church and knowing my own Christian life, sometimes the most powerful evangelists are not the ones who have the strongest theology or the long resume of Bible education. They're the ones who have recently had a compelling interaction with Jesus Christ. And because of that, they're like, "I have to go and tell the people. I might have just met the Christ." I mean, that's amazing. But she is unhindered by her testimony. She's unhindered by whatever those realities have been, and she simply says, "You got to come and see. Can this man?" And verse 30, they went out of the town and they were coming to him. Man, that's so cool. Now look at verse 31. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, saying, "Rabbi, eat." You know, they're probably like, "This is a weird situation. We don't know what happened. I went to get food, something, I don't know." So they've got the food. "Rabbi, eat." What's verse 32 said? "But he said to them, I have food to eat that you do not know about." Do the disciples get it yet? No, they don't, because look at the next verse. So the disciples said to one another, "Has anyone brought him something to eat?" I thought for a second this might be the first biblical example of like Uber Eats, you know? Like, did he get on his app? Did he? Probably not. Or DoorDash or Donkey Dash or whatever it was called back then. Yeah, so look at verse 34. He says this, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work." What he's saying is, you don't even know. My Father has me on a mission. And when I do what he's calling me to do, when I fulfill what he's asking me to do, it sustains me. It strengthens me. It does all the things that food does. It gives me the ability to continue. I have food you have no idea about. It's to do what my Father wants me to do. And I just got to say, while this is a relationship of Jesus with God the Father, I believe this is true for us too. Some of the times when I get discouraged or I get sidetracked or I get weary, I am not on the bullseye of doing what God wants me to do. He has a mission for me. He's saved me. He's given the gospel to me. He's given me the ability to serve other people. If I put my energy there, I'm going to respond through worship, and I'm going to share my faith with other people. He gives strength. He brings perspective. My thing doesn't seem as heavy as it did before when I'm on my Father's mission, okay? My food is to do the will of the one who sent me and to accomplish his work. Verse 35, do you not say there are yet 4 months and then comes the harvest? Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white for harvest. Already the one who reaps is receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor. Not only does he find satisfaction in doing the will of his Father, but he says, I want to tell you what's happening. So many times in Scripture, this image of sowing and reaping, and whether you know anything or nothing about agriculture, we all know this. Usually there's a time window between those two events. The sowing happens now. The seed goes in the ground. The harvest comes later, right? What he's saying to his followers is, listen, there's people, God has been at work. He's been sowing seeds, and you're about to see them reaped, and you have an opportunity to be a part of it. You could be used for God's agenda to draw other people to him. He's already using the woman at the well for that agenda. I'm not even sure she has a full faith in Jesus Christ, but she's a witness for Jesus Christ. And just think for a second. They're at the well. The woman went to town where the disciples had gone to get food. She told them about her encounter with Jesus, and the text tells us they're coming back. I don't know how this unfolded, but just think, when Jesus says, lift up your eyes, I mean, could he see them on the horizon? Look, look, they're coming. I don't know. I'm speculating. But he knew they were coming. There's about to be a harvest here. It's good for us to remember that we're not the first ones to do things for the Lord. This is not the first week of Harvest Bible Chapel. It's 30 years old. This is not the first time the gospel has been preached in North America because the gospel was brought to North America. There are so many historical things that we get to reap because God has been at work. I read this week. The reaping of people for the granary of God is not the task of any one group, nor is it confined to one era. Each reaps the benefit of its forerunners, and succeeding generations in turn gain from the accomplishments of their predecessors. As Paul said, I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God made it grow. And God is doing a work in John chapter 4 that's going to result in a harvest. And I believe that God's doing a work in our church and in our world that's going to result in a harvest. And I can be a part of it, and you can be a part of it if I will take my encounter with the living God through his son Jesus Christ and share it with others. You don't have to be articulate, but you got to be active, okay? I love this. Others were drawn in by her story. Why do I say that? Well, look at verse 39. Many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. Man, that stirs my faith. She didn't have it all figured out. I don't even know if she fully understood what was happening, but she told what she knew about Jesus. And many believed in him because of her testimony that he told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, it's no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this indeed is the Savior of the world. That's powerful. I came to check this out because of what you said, but when I've had my own encounter with Jesus, he's all of that and more. I believe this is the Savior of the world. That was their conclusion after that time. She had the unbelievable privilege of being a part of that story. Unsung, everyday person, uncommon faith. So I want to bring it home to us. I just want to ask a series of questions, and I want you to think about, where am I in this story? I want to ask you this first. Where is your greatest point of thirst today? I keep going after satisfaction in this way, or in this relationship, or in this path, but I'm finding that it actually cannot satisfy me. Where's your point of thirst? Have you found that even the best things in life are going to come up short when it comes to satisfaction of your soul? And I want to ask you this, what is your greatest point of need personally? That persistent sin, that awful reality, that painful thing that has been a part of my life. And are you willing to bring it to Jesus? He already knows it. He's not going to be surprised. He offers to respond in grace when we choose humility. Bring it to him. And how can you respond? And how can I respond this week by worshiping him in spirit and truth? Can I tell you, our pastors were laughing because we picked, our pastors on different campuses, picked this passage. We started working on it and we got into it. We're like, that's not one message, that's three messages. And we're kind of like, oh, okay. But it's God's truth. And our prayer is that this is not the last time you're going to be in John chapter 4, but you're going to go back to it yourself and read it and study it. We can worship the Lord in spirit and in truth as a response to him today and this week. And then I want to ask you this, who do you know that does not currently know Jesus Christ as Savior? And will you go tell him your story? I don't know if I can answer all your questions, but let me tell you what he did in my life. Let me tell you what he has shown me about who he is. This summer, summer's a good time to read books, right? I've been reading a book, and this is a wonderfully challenging book. It's called The Pursuit of God, by an author, Pastor A.W. Tozer. This is not three easy steps to anything. This is think deeply about who God is and how to pursue him. But I want to read to you a little section Tozer writes about a man named Frederick Faber. Do you know Frederick Faber? I didn't. He's a hymn writer. He's a hymn writer who wrote the hymn Faith of Our Fathers. But Frederick Faber was known for his passionate love for Jesus Christ. Let me read what's written of him. His love for the person of Christ was so intense that it threatened to consume him. It burned within him as a sweet and holy madness and flowed from his lips like molten gold. In one of his sermons, he says, "Wherever we turn in the church of God, there is Jesus. He's the beginning, middle, and end of everything to us. There's nothing good, nothing holy, nothing beautiful, nothing joyous, which he is not to his servants. No one need be poor, because if he chooses, he can have Jesus for his own property and possession. No one need be downcast, for Jesus is the joy of heaven, and it is his joy to enter into sorrowful hearts. We can exaggerate about many things, but we can never exaggerate our obligation to Jesus or the compassionate abundance of the love of Jesus to us. All our lives long, we might talk of Jesus, and yet we should never come to an end of the sweet things that might be said of him. Eternity will not be long enough to learn all that he is or to praise him for all that he has done, but then, that matters not, for we shall be with him always, and we desire nothing more." Our satisfaction is going to be found in Jesus Christ. Our refreshment comes from him. Draw near to him. Respond to him when he exposes the realities of our need. Worship him with a full heart and in truth. Witness for him. It's our great joy. That's where you're going to find refreshment in the Lord. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is truth, that it reveals to you who you are. It reveals to us your Son, Jesus Christ, who is the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through him. Lord, all that we need is not going to be found in this world. It's in you. Would you help us, Lord, to draw near, maybe for the very first time today? Would you help us to come back to you if we've wandered in some way? Lord, we need soul refreshment, and we recognize it can only be found in you. We love you, Lord. Lead us forward, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.